idea out of many things. One of them was a symposium a couple of years ago that was actually here in the other room that was organized by Akram Zatri with the Arab Image Foundation and the Centre Pompidou on the notion or phenomenon of the artist as historian. And as any good symposium will do, that one raised more questions than answers, and I think left a lot of the people who were there with a sense that these were questions that would come up again and that we would have the occasion to take up. And I'm hoping that this panel is an occasion to do that. But it was important to me to revisit that idea from the perspective of multiple disciplines and to treat the status of history in art as a material, as a medium, as maybe the enemy, not as a problem only of contemporary art, but as a problem of literature, of film. And and more specifically, this panel was conceived for three people, which obviously there are two, so we lost one. And it was only conceived for three people, so there wasn't really an option for us to replace the third person who's missing. But it was conceived very specifically for Jayce, who's an artist who's based in Vancouver, whose work over the past several decades has dealt with issues of representation, identity, history, in a range of places and conflicts in the world. And specifically now, because there's an important exhibition of his work at the American University of Beirut, which consists of one piece, which is Kan Wa Makan, which is a large, sprawling, room-sized installation of material collected and gathered between his first time in Beirut in 1988 and a longer time spent here in 1992. And what's going to be looping behind us is one film that figures into that installation, which is This Is Not Beirut, which is, it's a 48-minute film. He describes it as a personal essay. And it will loop probably twice in the time that we're sitting here. Just for those of you who haven't seen the show at AUB or who aren't familiar with the work, it'll give you a sense of that piece. And all the material that is in this installation, which is photographs, film clips, two videos, and then another bank of videos, a desk, a couch, endless quotations, Xerox copies, is all somehow related to how a place like Lebanon can be known. And the second person that the panel was conceived for, Elias Khoury, is one of the most preeminent novelists in Lebanon and in the Arab world, also known here as a journalist and an editor. And this is something that I think is becoming increasingly rare, someone who still lives out the role of a public intellectual. And someone who was also, back in the 1990s, the artistic director of Masra Beirut, and who has been the inspiration for a number of visual artists and has collaborated with a number of artists in Beirut. And Elias just finished his 14th novel, which is coming out in a week, and his previous novel before that, Sin Alcohol, has just been published in English translation, and that novel is the tale of two brothers who were rivals, set in Beirut in this sort of twilight period between 1989 and 1990. The third person that this panel was conceived for is the art historian Claire Bishop, who lives in New York, who recently wrote a very interesting and provocative essay called History Depletes Itself, on sort of, which was ostensibly her review of the Venice Biennale, but it was looking at whether or not artists had taken the use of historical material too far through the guise of one artist. I thought it was really important to have a historian on the panel, and I had really wanted someone with the rigor and methodology of the discipline to be here. And so I think we're all really sorry that she was not able to be here, and I'm not going to try to represent her thinking because I couldn't, but I might make some reference to her text. And without her, I think the conversation will become a little bit more focused than I thought it initially might be. But looking at the two works that we have of Jayce's work at AUB and Elias's novel, Sin Alcohol, we have two works that are set at a time when a historical narrative is meant to be ending, at a time when the story of the Civil War is supposed to be over. Yet, in Sin Alcohol, you have one character who, you have, the war is over, but it's still going on. You have one character who works in the demolition unit of an office that is sure to become solidaire, who's envisioning already the reconstruction of the city. And by the end of the book, you have the very clear sense of foreboding that one of the worst episodes of the Civil War is still kind of barreling towards the horizon. So I wanted to know, if there was anything, what the appeal of this particular time was for you, and if it was deliberate, why you wanted to set it at the end, not end.
Hello, good evening, everybody. Thank you for this panel. Discussing war and writing is very problematic. Regarding my own works, because my works are concentrated on two places, which both are Lebanon and Palestine, and in both situations, we are writing in the war, which never ends. That is, the supposition that the Nakba happened in 1948 is totally false and irrelevant. The Nakba is a continuous process. We are now living the Palestinian Nakba. So when we write about the Nakba, we are not writing about the past, although we are using elements from the past, but we are writing about the present, or in the present, let's say. We never write about anything. We write in the thing. In the Lebanese case, we have the same situation. The civil war ended, but it never ends. And actually, the outcome of the civil war was a new system, which I call the system of the civil war. We are living in a political system which is the system of the civil war, of reproduction of the civil war. And what we were witnessing the last months, this small interesting uprising of the young people, was against the system of the civil war, was an attempt to put an end to the civil war. On the other hand, the Solidaire project, as was conceived, because I was part of this huge cultural opposition to the Solidaire movement, we conceived, we must make an autocritique of our position now, because our concept was that Solidaire is coming to abolish the memory of the Civil War. Actually, Solidaire was part of the Civil War, and abolishing the memory, which is true, was part of renewing the war, because memory puts the separation, actually, between the past and the present. When we speak about memory, we are speaking about the past, not about the present. Whereas the project of the ruling class, which was backed by our both Syrian and Saudi brothers, was to create a system which can have inside it the continuation of the war. So actually, we are living in the war, and we are not, and when we are writing, we are not writing history. And this is something very important, because my novels, I'm not a historical novel. History, actually, a historical novel, as Lukács taught us once upon a time, is an attempt to interpret the past in the eyes of the present. Whereas what we are doing is an attempt to live the present, to survive the present, is to write the language of survival, which is based actually upon three major components. One is the freedom to express and to share what we feel with others. Second is to write the language of the oppressed and the marginals, which through it we can innovate our language, and third is to be defend justice. So we have three levels which are not contradictory, which are complementary, but which precisely do not try to make an interpretation of history. It tries to make an interpretation of life inside a mad historical moment. Now, when the political meaning of the, of these wars will end, it will end, both the Palestinian issue and the Lebanese issue, in the end, they will end. And then what will be left from what we are doing, I hope that what will be left from what we are doing is not a historical account, it's more a human approach, it's more an innovation of the language, an innovation of the ways of perception and the ways of seeing.
Okay. What? And Jayce, do you want to talk about the sort of oddness of revisiting this work? So the material in Kanwa Makan is from 88 to 92, and then the first installation of it as an installation is in 1995. What does it mean for you now to see this work again in 2015? Like, what does that time mean for you, given that at the time you were doing what you, I mean, in some of the pieces in the installation you described as pseudo-documentary or personal essay, you were definitely dealing with questions of representation that have probably changed since then?
Sure, I can't just say ditto. Okay. Because I look at my work as a form of writing, as the visual art, the installation, especially the video. I research and produce it in the sense of the same way if I was going to write. I don't know if that's makes sense. So there's a lot of corollary and parallels to what Elias is saying. To look at it now, it's very strange because, of course, I made it. I was living here and then elsewhere, working about here, this here, when I was living elsewhere. So to look back on it, for me, it's like digging into your scrapbook, in a way, and putting it on the wall and bringing it to Beirut for the first time. Is especially strange because it was always made for an audience, a Western audience outside of Beirut, and even though Beirut is, there's a very Western element here, it's still bringing it home in a way it makes me very nervous. It's like revealing yourself to your parents almost, or to your family when you were able to escape after high school and never had to go back again. So in a way this has been like showing in many other countries in the world, things that I developed here. So bringing it home here is a sort of a test for me, sort of test the working of what is now history and the histories that were incorporated into this project and seeing how they resonate with a local public. Because within this installation, it's made in the 90s and 80s, but it's looking at how we arrived at that point and how those contemporary moments arrived and the history of the construction of like southern Lebanon, for instance, and the occupation of southern Lebanon and Palestine and Lebanon itself is incorporated into this installation. So it's sort of these multi-layers of return, in a way, to this material.
And I think it's one of the interesting positions that Octavian Asenu takes as the curator of this show, is to position it as a historicizing effort. And I think it's as we discussed earlier, it's meant to be an open question. But it seems like there's one sort of cultural impasse, one critical impasse, which is to say that all the work that is being produced in Lebanon is about the Civil War, which kind of leads you nowhere. And then there's another more recent compulsion, which is to start historicizing practices that have developed since the 1990s as an art historical narrative. But it seems like, it seems that coming towards the end of homeworks after seeing, 10 days so far of one speaker and event after another, the emergence of certain common themes where you see a number of different artists and thinkers really grappling with what the hell has been happening to them in Egypt, in Syria, in Iraq, in the face of money, in the face of capital, over the past couple years in Lebanon since August now, which is a sort of a new thing. It seems like if in talking about historicizing work from the 90s, all we have is the genre of the Civil War novel or the category of contemporary Lebanese art, that something of the political project or the political tensions that were in the work to begin with have been lost. And how do you feel that the framing of this show as being about the 90s loses some of that, risks losing some of that energy, or how can it be recaptured? Or does it need to be?
Yeah, no, I was really hesitant and resistant to being historicized, or to have this work historicized, because I've never thought of it that way, or my own practice that way, but it's always thought of it as using histories, looking at the histories to see how we have arrived at the present, and speculating where this is going. And so all the work that I've done, whether it's in former Yugoslavia, or with First Nations communities in North America, or in the Middle East, has always sort of combine this past, present, and future into the moment. So the historicizing of it, in a way, sort of sticks a knife through the heart of it. And maybe with that it will, maybe that releases some tension or something that will flow from it that can connect to people. But so I really don't know how it resonates now, but with any art project, you would hope that it still has some, appropriateness.
And you were saying, Elias, you were mentioning that you were part of the cultural opposition to Solidaire several years ago. Do you feel like that was the last moment when artists and writers and political activists kind of had a common cause in Beirut? Or do you think that that has reappeared as of August with the campaign against the trash?
Actually, the opposition to the Solidaire was more an intellectual work, and it was very wide, and the defeat was very tough on all of us, because we were astonished to find out that all the members of the parliament voted for Solidaire, whereas all the artists and architects and writers were against Solidaire. So they didn't take into consideration anything which we have written or said. And they were right, in the sense that we were in a trap. And we didn't understand that these guys are the civil war itself. And that if we want to struggle against the civil war, which what is done actually in August, beginning August, it's another process which must be done, and it's not for sure under the title of defending the memory, but it will be under the title of beginning something new. Now, the movement which began in August intellectually is smaller, but it is popularly, and especially with the young people, it's much larger. And I don't know what are the potentials of this movement, seeing what's going on in the surrounding Arab world, where we are surrounded by catastrophes, and where now we can read our Lebanese civil war as a small rehearsal of the Syrian war. You see, with history, the meanings of things will change totally, and this is a very big danger in culture. That is, when culture is, if I accept your assumption that we have produced only novels of the Civil War, which is not true. I totally disagree with the assumption. My assumption is that the Civil War was a door for the Lebanese novel to become a real genre and to become part of the cultural scene. And of course, most of the novels are situated in the war, not because they are writing about the war, but because they are writing about life. And what's important in these novels is still relevant, I suppose, and is the profound innovation in the language, in the approach, and in the ways of of seeing things with new eyes, which actually destroyed the Lebanese dominant ideology, which was, as it was represented by, mainly by poetry and by the Rahbani and Saad Aal and etc., was a kind of a romantic, nice, we all love each other and we are the best people on earth and the cedars are, etc. All this bullshitting a la Lebanese, or megalomania Lebanese, it was totally destroyed. Now, of course, in the literary works or in the works of art, there is a part which is history, of course. In anywhere, if you read, you cannot read Tolstoy without history, you cannot read, but what is important is that, and you know this historical details takes lots of time. You have to make researches for to be accurate, because you cannot not be accurate, because the reader will not take you seriously. But in the last analysis, these elements, these historical elements, are only the first step towards something else. And this something else is how literature and art can be a tool of survival first, a tool of survival in a catastrophe like the catastrophes of wars, and second, how literature and art can try to reinvent itself and to make what I call the dialogue, the real dialogue. And the real dialogue of literature is not only with the living, the real dialogue of literature is with the dead. Literature is maybe the only place besides religion, and I'm not in that, I'm not religious at all, so I don't want to speak about the ways religion make this kind of dialogue between the dead and the living, because in religion, the dead govern the living. Whereas in literature, the living and the dead are equal, and we communicate with the dead. We read them, and we suppose that they are reading us. And this dialogue, I think, is the essence of the artistic and the literary project all in all. And here, history, of course, is very important. Man is a historical creature, and you cannot be outside history. But history also is stupid and blind. In the end, we'll discover, yani, every time we speak about ancient wars, the wars of the Egyptians with the Assyrians, you are with whom? This is bullshit, I mean. This is not important. What's important is Gilgamesh. And what's important is the Book of the Dead. In 300 years after this Zionist madness will finish in Palestine, because I hope it will finish, it will not continue forever, then all this will be, all the disaster that was the outcome of it will be totally meaningless in history. And what will be left is the ability of literature and art to arrive to the essence of the human suffering, and to read and write this suffering.
Could you maybe address more specifically those innovations in language that you were talking about? In that, I mean, I know that you often you use classical Islamic poetry often as references and folkloric references. How could you talk a bit about, like, how you pull them into your storytelling and the density of your storytelling?
No, actually, you know, the writer is the worst man to speak, or woman to speak about his work, because either he thinks it's great, or in my case, now I finished the novel, you think that it's meaningless. So, and you are not the one who can. But let's suppose that I am a professor at the university and teaching literature, and then try to find out things. And I think the innovation in language had many levels, but one of them is not only using the colloquial, because we are using the colloquial a lot, but using the colloquial syntax in the structure of the written Arabic, which is something totally new, which is, I think, a push really forward in the innovation of the language, which began in the 19th century with the Nahda, who who created what we call now the standard Arabic. And this standard Arabic now is pushed towards new limits where it can incorporate the spoken and the written together. And I think this is the major way of innovating the language, because you innovate the language through the spoken, not through the dictionaries and so on. The second major thing is to narrate in a different way. And narrating in a different way means, not only means that we now try to begin from the place where 1001 Nights began, where you have the story which opens to stories and stories that do not finish, and where narrating is not an expression of life, but it's living, it's life itself. That is, we live because we narrate. But also to arrive to this, what we can call in literary criticism, dialogical text, where you have different points of views, different approaches that work together, and that create a canva which is multiple, and which is not neither a political nor a moral message, but it's rather an opened book. And the opened book makes from the reader the real writer. Actually, we writers, I think all the time that I write as a reader. And actually, I began this career of being a writer because when I was very young, and every time I used to read a book which I thought is beautiful, I thought I'm its writer. So I all the time felt that I'm writing, I have written all the books of the world. So then why not writing now? But actually we write as readers. This is the essential thing, which permits the reader to read as a writer. That is to reinvent the book himself. Here we do not have a story which begins and ends in the classical linear narrative. Here you have a multiple story which, in order to relate it to your friend, if you want to relate it, you have to reinvent it. You cannot relate it the way it's written because it's impossible. So this openness, I think, is a way to make the link, a new link between reading and between living on one hand, and between reading, living, and writing on the other.
No, this is really interesting because I was thinking that the two of your approaches were very different, as a novelist being telling a story and a visual artist making an installation that required viewers to find, sort of pick their own way through it. And I know one of the arguments in Claire's essay is that there's, and this is of work that's very different from yours, but is the risk that history becomes, the use of historical material, the use of documents, the use of historical facts, the use of, traces, archaic, often obsolete forms of events, that this often becomes, an artist treats this as sufficient. It becomes sufficient. So like without interpreting it, without telling a story about it, just like presenting it all as historical material, and that the risk then further is that it's sufficient, it becomes ornamentation, it becomes decoration, it becomes about material taste. So it's therefore, and the argument is that actually this is, it's conservative. Because it's actually not, it's sort of abdicating its responsibility to tell a story. And I know, I mean, I have a very strong sense that your work works against this in about six different ways, but I wanted you, because you demand that the viewer comes to your piece and does some work. And so I wanted you to talk a little bit about the sort of, the stage set that you create for the viewer to walk in, and like the kind of work that you demand of them to do. And why?
That's a tough one. I always demand a lot from the viewer, and like Elias was saying, for the writer, the reader becomes the writer, the viewer and the person that chooses to engage with my work is always has an onerous task of placing themselves within it, and through the fields and the parameters that I've set up, creating their own understanding of the work. So with paradigms, the viewer takes responsibility, whether they realize it or not, for their own understanding. So within, and it's the same with the video as well as the installation, but it's in different forms. So the working through the process of entering this installation, for instance, there's little clusters of meaning set up. There's a little like narratives, if you will, but they're not strict with open and beginnings and closings, but there's ways that the viewer is led through the installation, and then there's a lot of openness for them to piece what it is they want to follow throughout, because to look at everything in the installation and to piece it all together would take probably days, because there's like 1,400 documents. But in any one of these layers of documents, if you look at one stack, there's links and there's a flow. There's an array, there's panoramas, there's clusters, and I sort of defined them strategically in the installation that way. So, and it's the same way in the video, using like sequencing or creating a form or new forms to talk about things in meaningful ways, so that to get away from the old forms that became meaningless because of the form, like this the realism of fiction film, for instance, while creating a dialectical or a dialogical sort of structure, so that every step along the way you are conscious of what is being done to you, but still allowing you to engage and have a pleasurable moments, but then being sort of questioning of those resolutions throughout the piece. And so the installations function that way. So when developing the video or the installation, it's the same way, trying to develop an appropriate form that was also could provide a critical commentary on what was produced before about similar material or in that sort of documentary or ethnographic mode, and produce new forms of reading that would not just witness survival, but witness the living and the willpower of different individuals engaged in those moments.
Can you?
No, you should have sent us this text.
I sent it to him.
You didn't send it to me.
I'm sorry.
And no, because I thought the ideas are very interesting and very challenging. And I think there is a point in seeing that in the archives, there is something reactionary. Only using the archives, there is something reactionary. And actually, when I published The Gate of the Sun, I spoke about a massacre which took place in a village in Galilee, which is Ain Zaytun. And actually, there was a huge massacre in Ain Zaytun, but then there was an Israeli historian whose name is Tom Segev, who wrote a long article in Haaretz saying that, do not believe this man, because Benny Morris, who's another new Israeli historian, did not mention Ain Zaytun in his book about the problem of the refugees, and because there are no documents. Then later, in the debate in Haaretz, the documents began to emerge. And I didn't have documents. All what I have was oral history. People told me about this massacre, and I collected the material, and I built it inside my novel. Now, in my new novel, there is a debate between a historian and the narrator. And the narrator received a letter from his, he has the letter from his grandfather, who was a soldier in the Ottoman army during the First World War, and who was taken as prisoner to Siberia. And he wrote this letter about the conditions of the prisoners of war in Siberia. The historian came and he was searching if this man was a member of the Red Battalion, which was created by the Bolsheviks. And my narrator told him, I don't know, but it seems he was a leftist, my grandfather. He said, but I need a document. So my narrator will tell him, I can add one sentence to this, to his letter, so you'll have the document. And he said, this is bullshit, this is literature, not history. And here my narrator will tell him, but look, all our history in all, we do not have the documents of our history because we are defeated. So do you think that we do not have history? So in this sense, I think this playing with documents and not playing with documents is a very important issue, especially in visual arts, which is becoming in the visual arts a kind of a totem which everybody kneels before, and which I think can play a very reactionary role because it deletes the major element, which I think is the major element in art and in literature, which is the critical element.
How was it that you ended up the artistic director of Masra Beirut?
I didn't end, I began, actually.
How did you begin?
I ended as a novelist, now I'm ending. I was before Masrah Beirut, Raja Assaf was a very close friend of mine, and I used to work with the group, the Hakawati thing, in a very, and I was fascinated by theater. And then it was in 1991, 92. I was in, Rabi Amrouwe made one of my novels a play, which was the journey of Little Gandhi. And the play was taken to Carthage. We were in Carthage, Carthage Festival. And at that time I thought, but we don't have any theater in Beirut because I wanted to show the play. Rabi asked me to find a place to show it. So I contacted LAU, where I teach now. And they refused because there is one character who's a Protestant and I'm mocking. They thought that the text was mocking of him, and this is a missionary school. This was the... So I thought we have to make a theater. And then we discovered that Theater of Beirut was closed and it's still there. So we made a group of people and we collected money from ourselves and then from other people. And then we ended by finding sponsorship from France Bank, and we opened the theater. But we were with a very low budget, actually. We were not like in this time of globalization, where we were very, very, very poor. But actually, what was there was an attempt to. The idea was first to recreate a space of debate, of cultural debate. So it was not only a theater. Of course, we opened it for the new generation of artists, and most of the new names first showed their works in Beirut theater, both in theater and in cinema and in installation and in visual arts, but also a place of debate. And a place of rethinking the war and rethinking. This is why one of the major plays was The Memories of Job, which I wrote and Raja Assaf directed, which was about the kidnapped, about the 17,000 Lebanese kidnapped. It was shown in 1993. So this was the idea. Of course, the idea ended in 1998. Because 1998 was the 50th anniversary of the Palestinian Nakba, and we made a huge manifestation for 3 months. And then the funders did not like the idea. And the governing tool, which was a Syrian tool, did not like it at all because they thought we are bringing back the Palestinians to Beirut. And so the whole experience ended, but I think it should have ended, because nothing will live forever. And those who think that they can continue the same work forever will finish like the Assad, who thought that he will govern Syria forever.
But do you still feel close to visual artists? Or, I mean, could you imagine ever doing a different project that brought you back into the visual arts again?
No, actually, I did one visual. It was 3 posters when I was young, and also it was with Rabi Amrouwe, which I thought it was. It's still relevant. But actually, you cannot do everything. Unfortunately, you cannot do everything, and you have to choose and. And I thought that my real place is in writing. But of course, I'm ready to help, to participate, to write when there is something which I think it's I can do. Not only because also I'm not very very in that. I mean, I have problems with my eyes, so to speak about visual with your eyes, it's problematic.
And Jayce, I wanted to ask you because I mean, one way in which the two bodies of work that you've each produced is different, is that Elias is engaged in two places over and over again in his work, whereas you have moved a lot. And so I wanted, because I think if we saw only this work and only Kaelen Wilson-Goldie, it would be sort of misrepresentative of your work overall. I wanted to know how this work fits into your broader oeuvre for you at this point.
Well, this work occupied a large part of my 90s, basically 80s and 90s. So I think as an artist, you create work in reaction to what you did before, and you try not to repeat yourself, and try to create something that can extend that further in your work further, not just as topic, but as form. So works that I think this time of making the installation and this videotape and Tallinn Ajanub up to the south, where Walid Rada co-directed with me, was a very sort of potent time because we were working closely together for that year, and so I was able to produce a lot and then digest it after when I returned back to New York in 93. So you know, the works that I made after were in reaction to this formally were looking much different because of the abundance and the overwhelmingness of this type of material. I tended to refine them, and then so the methodology shifted. But I think working through these issues, these problematics, these histories, and looking at the oral history is sort of extended from this work and from up to the south, and then a lot of the work I did later, because before I was using mostly appropriated imagery, and then looking at how knowledges are constructed and how we come to know of Lebanon and what Lebanon as a construction means, especially in the West and for consumption elsewhere as well as consumption here, like how we end up looking at this form of identity. So I think after that, I was able to apply those notions elsewhere, and I went to like other areas like former Yugoslavia right after the NATO bombing, and asked and looked more closely sort of at setting up videos of oral histories of asking people about the time during Tito and during Milosevic, and then their speculations on the future and their analysis and their sort of understandings of those moments. So it becomes another historical record in a way, but it's also a form of witnessing and a way of spreading these subjective accounts to talk about history, where the only reasonable forms of history that can be produced are ones through subjectivity. So it's allowed me to continue that type of work. And then I took that into First Nations communities back home as well.
Not to forget, Yani, since you asked me about Masrah Beirut, actually after Masrah Beirut, we began a festival which was called the Eylul Festival. I'm sure many of you remember or have heard about Eylul Festival. It was Pascal Vigali and myself, and also it lasted for 5 years. And that festival was a major place for modern visual arts. And in that context, I wrote 3 posters. And I think the role played by the Eylul Festival must not be forgotten. I think this was the beginning of the beginning of the wave of modern arts, which now is developing in different ways and is giving great names and great artists and so on.
I mean, speaking of those important moments in the 90s, and Jayce and I touched on this a little bit when we did a talk at AUB, but when I met you for the first time in 2005, it seemed clear that you had played a sort of a key role among a certain group of artists in sort of coming here and bringing people together and doing the work that you were doing. And I mean, because it was you came to do this work and it became Up to the South, and Waleed was your young assistant at the time, and it was before the Atlas Group and before Ashgalawan and before the Arab Image Foundation. Is it strange for you to be a character who sometimes walks into this story and then retreats from it at this point? I mean, is it strange for you to be back here? And
yeah, it's really strange. I hadn't been here for 15 years. I came in September and then now. But before that, there was this 15-year gap. So I sort of liked my role before I came here. It was sort of as a phantom, like I would say. Because when I came here in the 90s, I brought 5 video cameras with me in an editing suite, and we let whoever wanted to use them to make films, and we set up a studio up above Jamaisi, and we had like parties, scotch parties, screening parties every Friday night, and people would come and hang out, and we'd talk about video and art and look at works, and we'd help people edit and develop their projects, and people were starting to come back that had gone during the 70s overseas to study Waleed Sadek and Ziad Abulama and Jalal Tufik. It was coming around that time. And so there was this really rich milieu of people sort of just assessing what could be done. And there was no real institution supporting it. So this sort of ad hoc media studio, gathering place was really interesting, important time. So we worked during that year, like going all through Lebanon and going into the occupied south. And because of our positions, or because of my position, Waleed was actually often very nervous, because I say, okay, I want to go into the south. So we had to pretend we were doing a film about farming to get to General Lahad's military advisor, and we're in there in the room with them, and he starts asking, well, this has nothing to do about farming. And I can see Waleed going, and we've got to move on. And so it was like we were bringing people from east to Beirut to west Beirut and vice versa that had never traversed it, because even though the checkpoints had come down psychologically, still people weren't moving that much, back and forth, and also going to the south. A lot of people had never been to the south, up to the occupied zone anyways, and so we would, we'd act as sort of local tour guides as well as doing our own projects. So that was a really potent time, and then leaving and then doing work afterwards and engaging the diaspora. Then coming back a few times up until 2000 and showing at Masra Beirut and places like that. And then not coming in for 15 years, it was interesting because the people I knew at that time, they did amazing work after that, and other people emerged. And so some of us kept in contact and we'd see each other. But I think there was, I was sort of just floating in the ether, so it was fine because I went on to do other things. So, but it was always absent, I thought. So it was always, it's strange coming back for sure, and because this history it's not very well known except from a handful of people.
Yeah. I can definitely ask questions until 9 o'clock, but I think maybe you have questions also. So if there's questions in the audience, we can start to do that, or I can continue as you like. Anyone? No?
Let me ask you a question. Your question, okay. So what generated your interest? Because you're one of the few, handful of 2 or 3 people that have looked back at the 90s and tried to piece together things that led up to the contemporary art scene here.
Why am I interested?
Yeah, and sort of what's your, why hasn't there been a definitive text that you or one of these other 2 people have come up with?
I don't think there can be a definitive text. I think the nature of it is to be always have these competing and contradictory texts. Because as soon as there's one text that tries to reconstruct this time, the critique of that text will be that it romanticizes and it's nostalgic, or that it's only because I didn't live it that I can write it in this way. But I think, someone must have a question. Yes.
Okay. I missed something maybe in this panel. There is visual artists, artists starting using archival documents or documents that are based in the past, not only to illustrate theories relating to history, but sometimes to flip them upside down, to question them, forge them. So I thought that element was missing in to imagine them also, to perform them, and performing them not only with one's bodies, but also inventing them exactly like writers do in literature. Yeah, I mean, I thought that was a little bit not properly expressed. I mean, as if historians are on one side and writers on the other side, and artists are somewhere not clearly defined. Yeah, I mean, because you mentioned the Haaretz thing, for example, the Haaretz article, as if Haaretz came to correct, or at least as if the role of the writer was a reminder that this village existed, and therefore reminded historians that they should bring the pictures and use them as evidence. I think art turns its back to all of this and tries to perform documents differently.
Akram Habibi, first you cannot tell me it's in art a specific event, and then tell me you are turning your back. First of all, the event is there. Now, from that on, you turn your back. But you cannot tell me this event. I'm not interested if it's happened or not. And then you give me the names and date details and so on. And then you tell me I'm not interested if it's true or wrong, because on one hand you are part of your time. So what you are discussing, what the difference is clearly, is not that I do not play with the document. And what Haaretz did,
you do play.
What Haaretz did is they did not criticize my way of playing with the document, because it was a long article by Tom Segev, which was all great book and so on and so forth, but he's a liar. Because I mentioned a specific name of a specific village. And I don't think we are permitted to go specific that way, the way I went, if it doesn't have a real elements in reality. But this doesn't mean that I wrote the real massacre of Ain Zaytun. Actually, I didn't write. I was not there, and I imagined the massacre. But there was a massacre. So the thing is not to turn your back. The thing is how to turn your back. This is the point. We cannot not be any way accurate in the point of departure. And then we are free as artists or writers. And we have to be free, because we are not historians.
Are historians able to write history with fiction? I'm not talking about facts.
It's all construction.
Are historians able to... I meant historians, not necessarily conventional historians or historians with the methodologies of historians, but historians, writers, or historians, visual artists. Are they able to write history with fictional documents or with imagining history?
Yes, of course.
This is what I'm
but yes,
about.
Of course, but then you, I was speaking about a special case.
Yes, sure. I mean, was not criticizing you.
Akram, in that special case, where I was saying, and I insist on that my point of departure was real, was accurate history, because actually one of the main battlefields with the Zionists now they admitted, khalas, it's over, we won this battle. To insist that there was a massacre, there were massacres, and the Palestinians did not leave on their own. So when you begin with that, you cannot not be accurate. Now, if you are not dealing with something very precise like that, then you can invent a history on your way, of course, and write it the way you want. And here the point of difference is not if it's accurate or not. It is if it's beautifully written or not, if it's real art or bullshit. So then the discussion will be on another level totally.
Where does poetry, in your opinion, stand while writing historical narratives or while working as a writer, as a visual artist? What does emotion?
You know, we speak.
What's the place of emotion?
I write prose, so we speak in literary criticism about the poetics of the prose. Everything is poetry in that sense. But also in our classical Arabic tradition, in all the books of narratives, you have a refer to poems. Yani, if you take Al Flayl, 1001 Nights, for example, Shahrazad will tell a story, and inside that story, when she wants to fix a meaning, she will recite two verses of poetry. So poetry plays the role of fixing things, which I do in my novels, which is actually, I did not invent this. This is part of a tradition that goes from 1001 Nights to Abu Hayyan al-Tawhidi to all the classical Arabic prose writing. And in this sense, poetry is an initial part in fiction, of course. Now, in visual arts, I think visual arts can only be read as poetry. I cannot read visual art.
I cannot disagree.
No, I cannot read visual arts as fiction, even if it has fictive elements. Visual arts must be read as a poem and must be analyzed as a poem, which has its different venues than analyzing prose.
If there's no question, there is one question, a third question from me. Also for Lies, when we write imagining an incident in the past, there is certain we're displacing ourselves, but yet in a very privileged position because we have seen what happened in the past 20 years, 30 years. So we can, we simply have that privilege. What determines where you want to displace yourself in time and imagine? Is it simply you're talking about a historical moment that you, then therefore you set your novel
there? Of course not.
I'm interested in...
No, this is simplifying things. I mean, what puts you anywhere you are is a general vision of what you are trying to, what story you are trying to tell. Actually, for myself, I do not think of neither of the historical moment nor actually, yani, the book which is the most political book I've written, which is Baby Shams, practically began in my head as a love story. There was nothing about Palestine. The idea was to write, you know, normally, because normally love stories in literature are the stories of separation. Yani, Romeo, Juliet, took everybody, it was all separation. I said, let's write a story of love which continues. A lover will marry his lover. What will happen? This was the idea. And then from that on generated that he lives in Shatila and she lives in Galilee. And in order to make the background of the love story, I finished by writing what is considered to be a Palestinian, whatever, epic. So the idea is where the situation you are in will lead you. There is nothing fabricated or a pre-framed thing. Otherwise, it's not art. Otherwise, it will be an ideological approach. And I don't think in literature or in cinema or in visual arts or whatever art you want to speak about, we can be ideological. Ideology is part, of course. We cannot escape. We struggle against ideology as much as we can, but ideology is part of it. But we cannot begin from an ideological approach. Otherwise, the outcome, and it's better to write an article, and I write articles, so why to bother yourself? You know, writing a novel and writing an article is something totally different, and writing a novel is torture. So why to torture yourself? You can write articles and everybody will read them and say you are intelligent. But the idea is not here. The idea is a totally different approach in order to go beyond all these frames that we are situated in.
Can I ask Akram a question?
Yeah.
I mean, I'm curious, because Hold on, we'll pass the mic back to you. Okay.
Hi. I mean, you're saying that art, we cannot frame it, and ideology and all this, but I mean, since the beginning you're saying art is this, I found it very weird, you know, to at one point say it's something we cannot grasp and frame, and on the second part giving like this kind of old 19th century things that art is this, I mean, yeah. I mean, I felt maybe some of us also that.
What did you feel? I'm interested in your feeling.
Feelings are important, yeah.
But well, I'm interested. I didn't get your feeling.
No, but you said, I mean...
what did you feel? I'm very interested.
It's been a long time I was in a lecture where somebody is telling what is art. I mean, I don't know. It's weird. I mean, it's not...
It's weird what?
I mean, you said three, four times, art is this, art needs to be, has this, art is...
No, we are not in a lecture, we are chatting, you see, and I'm trying just to formulate very vague ideas. Mm. And if you had the impression that I know and I'm trying to impose in a pre-supposed knowledge, I'm really sorry, I mis-expressed myself. I totally agree that that in the end, our definition of art must come from artistic works. This is why I was referring all the time to novels which I've written. I was not referring to my ideas. But you are totally right. If I was in this yani tunnel, thank you for your remark. It's very interesting.
Oh, I mean, I think it's probably worth noting that a lot of the artworks that we're talking about would have at some point not been considered art, and the act of defining them as art has been a kind of interesting task to take. But the question I had for Akram is, would you have a problem with historians calling themselves artists?
No, I think art is the most undefined, and that is problematic also sometimes. I mean, art is this territory that nobody can define, and collecting garbage can be art. I think garbage is the greatest archive about its society, not its photographs. So so I was trying just to widen or expand the discussion, because indeed there is a misunderstanding about artists who use archives, and we imagine even formal solutions for how to do that. But if you want to not bound art to any formal sketch or representation, then the idea can be as engaging, as critical as...
But I think there's also a wide range of artists who are working with archival material in a wide variety of different ways, and some of them may be working in a way that's similar to you and asking some of the questions you are, and some are working in a way that's very, very, very different.
Sure.
And you're not all the same and wouldn't have all the same answers to these questions, I think.
Sure, yeah. Yeah, I cannot disagree.
There's a question back here.
So something I'm worried about is, as an artist who sometimes works with history, is in contemporary art, in visual art, in the universities, there seems to be a trend towards science. So, you know, we're all lamenting the closures of humanities departments, and I think this kind of celebration or excitement about science is also happening in art, and in this exhibition we sort of see a kind of the show downstairs. You see the way science is capturing more of the public's imagination. And I'm not saying that history and science are mutually exclusive, but I'm curious how you all feel about the rise of science.
Jayce.
Yeah, well, you're right. I mean, I think next to the archive, or during this sort of fetishism of the archive that artists have captured over the last, say, 10, 15 years, and all these exhibitions that started in the 90s, late 90s, about storage and about accumulation. At the same time, people were starting to promote artistic collaborations with scientists and with art. So I don't think these modalities are separate, but like Ilya said, we can't do everything, right? So in our practices, we choose the modalities we want to work in. And in I think both of our cases, we haven't engaged science directly. But I look forward to seeing your work doing so. I'm just going to continue a little bit about the fictionalization or using histories through the subjective. When I filmed Suha Bashara, who in 1999, shortly after she was released after 10 years of detention in El Qiyam. Now, if you mention El Qiyam, probably 3/4 of the people in the room don't know what it was, because it's a generational thing. And when I made this film and showed it in North America, 99% of the people didn't know about the detention center of El Qiyam and the other detention centers throughout southern Lebanon and in Palestine, or the history of them. So uncovering these histories as an artist sort of wasn't just a mission of witnessing these histories or recognizing subject matter that needed to have a vehicle. It was being able to collaborate, and with the person on the other side of the camera, it was a performative thing. So whenever anybody's recounting this history, it is a form of performance and it's a form of construction, and there's ties to the actual history. So, but these interpretations is what makes it interesting. So if you see this film, it's part of the video library at the AUB show. It's like 45 minutes long. It's just a conversation. All you see is Suha Bashara talking to the camera. And you might look at it as a historical document, or you could look at it as a performative piece.
I had a question for Elias Khoury again. I was wondering, as someone who works as a journalist, as well as a novelist, is there a tension for you between working, for example, with oral testimony? Obviously, as a journalist, you would approach that from a very strict perspective where you only quote exactly what somebody said. You never try to interpret the thought behind what they say unless you've clarified it with them. As a novelist, you said something earlier about kind of trying to express the essence of somebody's experience, somebody's suffering. How do you kind of balance those two different approaches to historical documentation or to interviews?
Yeah. Actually, it was a very tough experience to balance. And actually, I never arrived really to balance. And I ended by using my journalistic work as a raw material for my novels, to tell you the truth now. And in this sense, journalism is an excellent school, which teaches you observation and ways of putting things together and arriving to a summary. You must be very precise in journalism, which teaches a novelist a lot. But practically, there is something double in this life, in these two jobs. And in the end, I finished by only writing a chronicle, not writing real journalism. I was, since very long time, I was an editor-in-chief of the literary Mulha supplement of Al-Nahar, but actually I stopped writing reports, and I only wrote one piece, which was a piece of opinion, which did not matter at that point. But it's a tough work, especially now. Now journalism is becoming a very tough job in a place like Beirut, because journalism is dying, like everything in this beautiful city is dying. And the big question is how to revive it. Journalism, and how to reinvent journalism, because practically we are living without journal, without newspapers. The biggest distribution, if you know the numbers, you will be totally astonished. It's very depressing.
I have a question, yeah? The question is, to pick up to Akram's question, what are the consequences of this work in a country like Lebanon? I mean, like, if we use documents, which are poetry, visual art, novels, my question is, what would be the consequences of such a work in a country where there is no public archives? Meaning, like, we don't know who killed who, and where do you situate... It's an open question, yeah? But how would one situate an art practice which is there's no history done in parallel to it?
No, actually, you are totally right. I mean, what is left, which I think is left mainly, is that we can accuse. And I mean, the major work done by artists and here I'm speaking about novelists or visual artists. The things I know about were when you arrive to points like that, you accuse. I mean, you accuse the system, you accuse the dominant class, you accuse the ways things are done. But practically, you are right. We don't have access to archives. We don't have archives.
Thank
we
you.
Don't have any something which. Only in the Arab world you have it in Egypt, which is what is called the National Archives. And also the National Archives in Egypt, for example, are closed. I mean, till now, you cannot have an access to the archives of the 1967 war, which happened yani, when we were kids, before you were born a long time ago. And of course, the war of 73. And so this is why we do not have any serious historical works about 67, which was the disaster, the major disaster of the Arab world, and which led us, I suppose, to where we are now in this total garbage of Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi and Bashar al-Assad and company. So, this is what makes things very, very tough and makes writing about them a kind of an attempt to collect oral testimonies on one hand, and of accusing the dominant structure on the other.
Yeah, the problem with an archive is that you assume that it's containing all the histories that are missing. And in the absence of a public archive, I think is providing this ground for a lot of these important works to be done. I mean, there is a multitude of private archives in this area and that people have collected like during the 70s, 80s, and 90s. And that richness of material and those idiosyncrasies provide the subjectivities and the subject matter for a lot of creative work. And I think that becomes even more potent than a public archives would be.
I suppose, for example, that if one wants to study the Lebanese Civil War, his major references must be the novels and the works of visual art. The works of historians, of course, we have works of historians, but they are very marginal and very limited. And maybe the only documents we have, unfortunately, are the works of art. And in this sense, art can fill a gap, but this is not its job. Although I don't know what's art, but I know what it is not art.
Just in the 2 seconds before the mic reaches you for the question here, this was a point of Claire's piece that I feel like I should represent, was that she has one sort of a paragraph aside saying that her argument about history as ornamentation and as decoration doesn't apply. Like the counter example is artists from Lebanon working on the Civil War, artists in Eastern Europe working on the fall of communism, where in the absence of official archives, this becomes really important work. And I guess one of the ideas was, I was hoping that Claire could be here to sort of push this idea more, because I think there's also the sense that maybe that's too easy. But there is a question over here.
Yeah, hi. I have a slight pronunciation problem, but I hope it's fine and it's clear. I have a remark more than a question. It could be taken as a question later on. But when they talked about dialogical text, and Jayce Salloum talked about the audience having to actually interact with the artwork and have to know a little bit about something in order to really understand what's it all about. So I question the target audience, and I think it's a bit elitist. Art in Lebanon is a bit elitist, and how can we reach the actual public which we want to reach, which are وليد الضاحية وليد الشمال الجنوب الباقى. So how do these artworks really, how do they really function as history, as an educative tool for the public? Thank you.
No, that's a question that I always think about, like this, the uselessness or the usefulness of what it is we spend our days doing and our years and our decades. And after a while, whatever decades are, not quite centuries, but the usefulness of it. So I think for me, I try to work in a variety of mediums, right? I'll make films that can be shown at homes, in clubs, and given back to people to take to their home communities. And like the instance of this installation, I hope it's very tangible so that anybody can walk in it. And before things started getting stolen, like a few weeks ago, they were able to touch a lot of the works and leaf through the documents and have this tactility and this relationship with the material that was, really direct. And, I've shown these in museums where the guards tell me it's the first time we've been told to tell the people that they can touch the artwork, But as far as reaching other communities of people that don't wander into the gallery, it's very difficult. And when I do works, I do try to always give raw footage back to the people that I'm filming and to the material. So in the case of like First Nations histories, Indigenous histories in Canada, oftentimes these are what people use to tell their own histories to their children, these videotapes and these films, which were the first records of their families. And so it's very limited, but you can only do so much. There's definitely a limit. Yeah.
Have you been to see the installation at AUB?
Yes, I have.
Okay. So I mean, it doesn't look like an intimidating work of art, right?
No,
I mean, you can go in and you can. I mean, it looks like you're walking into someone's studio. So I mean, I think the question there is, I mean, technically, anybody, any member of the public, technically can go into that space. But, it's a closed campus, but the gallery is open, so you have to, negotiate your way in, you have to know that it's there. I mean, these are the
that's right.
Barriers.
Yeah. But also for a book, let's say, who actually reads the books. It's really a general thing I always think about. It's not that I want an answer right now, but yeah. It's
that's a good question. You're shaking your head here.
Sometimes to take off this intimidation towards artworks and everything related to arts and culture, maybe we need to reintroduce the concept of cultural mediation. And there is this concept in France, and there are some majors here in Lebanon that are being established recently. So I think that might be one of the solutions.
You are totally right. In my personal experience, I feel this very much. For example, 5 years ago in the French baccalaureate, there was a question about Yalu, about a novel of mine, which I'm not in the canon in this country, I am totally outside the frame because they think that we are not writers, and they are right, maybe. But the point is the work, and I've witnessed by chance, because when my books were translated to French, how there is real mediation, how they take the books to the schools and to the universities, and it's a whole work which is done by the public administration, because they think that culture is important. Now here we are on our own. And to be on your own, you cannot do these things, actually. You you try your best, and you hope that one day people will read the audience that you like, to reach will be reached. But it's not easy at all. It's very, very tough on the personal or in a small avant-garde collective work. This must be done in another another structure.
Thank you.
Okay. Could you ever imagine writing a novel set in the future? A novel set in the future.
You know, what's the future, actually? I mean, in a situation like ours, can you distinguish between the future and the past? Do you think that 10 years ago, if someone will imagine Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi and write a novel about Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, people will read it as part of the future or as part of the past? You know, future and past are very, very complex issues. But there is the science fiction, and when you are in a country which doesn't produce science, we don't have real research, and we are outside the world. Actually, you cannot imagine, to go back to the science thing, which is very important. I think this work of artists with scientists is very important and very interesting, and can lead to new places. But in a country like ours, where we don't have science innovations, no science research centers in a serious way, then if I want to imagine the future, I must imitate European novels, which in my age, it's over. I cannot imitate anymore.
About the future, yeah, no. I rely on the kindness. I mean, on the intelligence of strangers to speculate about the future. So whenever I engage people, that's the level it's at. I'll use that material. I agree with what Elias said, of course. Ditto as well.
Okay.
About the work of art becoming a document of history and living in a region where very often I feel personally that reality is always overcoming fiction, like reality exceeds whatever we could have imagined. You say that eventually everything will end, but how will it end? Is that a question you ask yourself?
Actually, it will end because everything ends. I will die because everybody will die.
Yeah.
At least this. More than that, in our situation, really, really, I don't know. I feel that our region is entering a labyrinth, a terrible labyrinth. I'm not sure we are living in the 21st century. It is going back to the time of colonialism, or 19th century. Maybe we are going back to the Mongol invasion also. There is what they call the war of civilizations, which I think we must call the war of savageness, the war of two or more than two barbarism taking place all over the world. Actually, all what I am thinking of is how, through my work, because I cannot think about others, because every one of us is limited to what he does, we can survive. I think survival now is the major moral, ethical value. How to struggle to survive and how to invent survival in conditions like the conditions we are going through. How the 10 million Syrian refugees inside Syria and abroad can survive, and how we can imagine this and help in this, in order that some time will come that we will overcome this. Of course, this is very sad what I'm saying, because I feel that we, and when I say we, it's not only intellectuals, maybe it's all the peoples of this region, we are becoming outsiders in our countries. And the destiny of our countries is because of us, of course. We are responsible for that. I'm not denying our responsibility, and this must be discussed. But nowadays, we are totally outsiders, and the destiny of our region and the destiny of our suffering is in the hands of the regional and superpowers.
Thankfully, I don't feel the same way about that. I mean, maybe it's the generation gap. I don't know.
look, this generational thing, all the time. Of course, I understand there is generational problems, differences. Of course, 100%. But nobody told me it's a generational difference when I was in the demonstrations in the streets of Beirut. So it's not always generation. It can be also different points of views. And because putting it only on generations will destroy any debate. And then you are asking me to shut up, which I will not do it. I'm sorry.
I think on that note, thank you very much, Jayce. Thank you, Elias. Thank you, Christine. Thank you, Ashkelawan. Thank you, everyone, for coming.